Sutra contemplate the fundamental falseness of appearances. They are just like flowers that are conjured up in space and produce empty fruit. Why then investigate the meaning of their formation and disappearance? Commentary: when you look at appearances, contemplate their fundamental falseness. It's all like the sun's reflection in water just mentioned. There was an appearance, but it was illusory. The one sun became two. How did the change take place? When did it divide? You can't see it clearly. One person sees only one sun, but it follows him. The same thing happens to the other person, and you can't point out and explain clearly exactly how those appearances come into being. They are just like flowers that are conjured up in space and produce empty fruit. Why then investigate the meaning of their formation and disappearance? How can you determine that earth, water, fire, and wind overcome one another? How can you ask about their mutual destruction? Sutra, contemplate the fundamental truth of the nature. It is solely the wonderful enlightened brightness. The wonderful enlightened bright mind. Originally, it is neither water nor fire. Why then ask about incompatibility? Commentary: contemplate the fundamental truth of the nature. It is solely the wonderful enlightened brightness, the wonderful enlightened bright mind. These two phrases refer to the same thing. The second is just added for the sake of literary style. So, the wonderful enlightened mind. Originally, it is neither water nor fire. Although it is not either of these, it contains them both. The treasury of the first common is replete with that kind of functioning, but it doesn't originally manifest as water and fire. It is just the nature of water and fire. Why then ask about incompatibility? You still don't understand the principle of contemplating the nature, so you ask about the mutual destruction of the appearances of water and fire. You don't know that the nature of the treasury of the first common is complete with all the myriad dharmas and their functionings. You only know how to see the physical aspect of things, which although it exists, is basically false. It is just like the one reflection of the sun, which split in two and followed each person. Was it real? No, and that's the way all appearances are. Sutra, Purna, you think that form and emptiness overcome and destroy one another in the treasury of the first common. Thus, the treasury of the first common accordingly appears to you as form and emptiness throughout the Dharma realm. Commentary, Purna, you think that form and emptiness overcome and destroy one another in the treasury of the first common. You here does not just refer to Purna. It refers to you and me and everyone here investigating the Shurangama Sutra. You think that form and emptiness are incompatible and that they battle with one another and destroy one another in the treasury of the first common. Thus, the treasury of the first common accordingly appears to you as form and emptiness throughout the Dharma realm. Since that's what you think, that's what happens throughout the Dharma realm. Sutra, and so within it, the wind moves, emptiness is still, the sun is bright, and the clouds are dark. The reason for this lies in the delusion of living beings who have turned their backs on enlightenment and dried with the dust. Thus, the wearisome defilement comes into being and mundane appearances exist. Commentary, and so, since form and emptiness continually overcome one another in the treasury of the first common, there arises the function of according with conditions. Because of this, form and emptiness come into being and their appearance and functioning pervade the Dharma realm. Within it, within the nature of the treasury of the first common, the wind moves, emptiness is still, the sun is bright, and the clouds are dark. The reason for this lies in the delusion of living beings. In the midst of so many appearances, living beings become muddled and clear. They don't understand the principle of true emptiness, and so they are muddled. Therefore, in the true emptiness of the nature of the treasury of the first common, they give rise to the three subtle delusions and the six cause delusions. One unenlightened thought produces the three subtle appearances. States become the conditions for the growth of the six cause appearances. As I explained above, the three subtle appearances are the appearance of karma, the appearance of turning, and the appearance of manifestation. The six cause appearances are the appearance of knowing, the appearance of continuity, the appearance of grasping, the appearance of reckoning names, the appearance of the arisal of karma, and the appearance of suffering bound to karma. When living beings give rise to these appearances, they are confused. Once confused, they turn their backs on enlightenment and joined with the dust. They turn away from the true nature and get involved with the experiences of the six sense objects. And this is all because they think that in the nature of the treasury of the first common, there is mutual incompatibility. Since they turn their backs on enlightenment and get mixed up with defilements, the wearisome defilements come into being and mundane appearances exist. The mountains, the rivers, and great earth, and the continuity of the world come into being. Sutra, with a wonderful brightness that is not extinguished and not produced, I unite with the treasury of the first common. Thus, the treasure of the first common is the unique and wonderful enlightened brightness which completely illumines the Dharma realm. Commentary, with the wonderful brightness, the wonderfully enlightened bright mind that is not extinguished and not produced. Here the Buddha is referring to himself, unite with the treasury of the first common. Thus, the treasury of the first common is the unique and wonderful enlightened brightness. There is only the wonderfully enlightened bright mind, which completely illumines the Dharma realm, shining on absolutely every place. Sutra, that is why within it, the one is limitless. The limitless is one. In the small appears the great. In the great appears the small. Commentary, in the nature of the treasury of the first common, the one is limitless. The limitless is one. One is all and all is one. In the small appears the great. In the great appears the small. Great and small are unobstructed. One and many are unhindered. You can also say that the one represents the treasury of the first common, which can manifest the myriad dharmas. And the myriad dharmas all return to the treasury of the first common. The one can also refer to the one mind in that the myriad dharmas are all from the mind. The mind contains the myriad dharmas. The true mind is the treasury of the first common. The treasury of the first common is the true mind. You can't use the limited knowledge of ordinary people to reflect upon the subtle, wonderful, enlightened, bright mind with its inconceivable transformations. You never totally understand it that way. Sutra, unmoving in the Bodhimanda, yet pervading the 10 directions. My body contains the 10 directions and endless emptiness. On the tip of a single hair appear the lands of the Jewel Kings. Sitting in a mold of dust, I turn the great Dharma wheel, destroy the defilements, and unite with the enlightenment. So, true suchness, the wonderful enlightened bright nature, comes into being. Commentary, unmoving in the Bodhimanda, yet pervading the 10 directions. This phrase refers to the Buddha's Dharma body in the Bodhimanda, which does not move but goes to all countries in the 10 directions. My body contains the 10 directions and endless emptiness. Not only does it pervade all Buddha lands, but even fills up empty space. Well, if empty space is filled up, does it then cease to be empty? Does it wipe out empty space? Does it obliterate emptiness? Know what pervades the ten directions and endless emptiness is the Dharma body, which has no appearance. On the tip of a single hair appear the lands of the jeweled kings. This is truly an inexpressibly wonderful state. All the Buddha's lands appear in a single hair. This is the dependent appearing in the proper. The body is the proper retribution. The Buddha lands are the dependent retribution. So in the smallest division of the proper retribution, a single hair appears the largest division of the dependent retribution, the Buddha lands. In the small appears the great. Sitting in a mode of dust, I turn the great Dharma wheel, where the mode of dust refers to a mode of dust bordering on emptiness, which is 1/7 of the smallest division of the dependent retribution. In it appears the great, the Buddha's body, as he turns the Dharma wheel to teach and transform living beings. Thus, in the small appears the great, and in the great appears the small. Ultimately, how can it be like this? It is the wonderful functioning of the Buddha Dharma, a glimpse of the Buddha's nature. Another example of the great appearing in the small is when we hold up a mirror to reflect miles and miles of scenery. In order to know about this state, you have to understand the principle of the unobstructedness and perfect fusion of nomina and phenomena. It's just what is meant by the one being limitless and the limitless one, which was discussed above. It also pertains to the meaning of Dadani, which is together in all dhammas and hold all meanings. And when does this gathering occur? In the Buddha nature. After you hear more sutras, you will naturally come to understand this principle. This doctrine is so inexpressibly wonderful that I'm not going to say any more about it now. The Buddha says that, sitting in a mode of dust, he turns the great Dharma wheel. Someone with virtue in the way can turn the Dharma wheel to teach and transform living beings in all three realms, the three realms of peace. When you don't see him, you may sometimes be in the heavens teaching living beings by lecturing the sutras and speaking Dharma. Sometimes he may be in the house lecturing sutras and speaking Dharma to teach living beings. Sometimes he goes into a mode of dust to turn the Dharma wheel in order to teach and transform living beings. Although a mode of dust is small, the living beings within it are no fewer than the number of living beings in this world. This state is inconceivable and inexpressible. To describe it in words is just to reveal its superficial aspects. Why do living beings have to be living beings? Because they are blocked with the wearisomeness of definement. They turn their backs on enlightenment and unite with definement. The Buddhas have been able to destroy the definements and unite with enlightenment, so through suchness, the wonderful enlightened bright nature comes into being. Our true mind is the treasury of the first common, and different names for the same thing.